Relative democracy, you can, you know, for example, we have the Better Neighborhoods project, where every year people get to spend or create a budget, you know, to spend part of the city budget. You know, it's a real thing. It's not a big part of the budget. It's, you know, we tell them we have some electronic democracy. You can, you know, for example, we have the Better Neighborhoods project, where every year people get to spend or create a budget, you know, to spend part of the city budget. You know, it's a real thing. It's not a big part of the budget. It's only like 5 or 8% of the construction budget of the city, you know, something like that. But people say, oh, you know, it doesn't really matter. They're not even going to listen to us. But actually, this project is actually, you know, people put forward ideas about sort of smaller construction projects in their neighborhoods. And actually, those projects then actually get voted on, and everybody makes their own budget, and they get voted on. And it's been going on since 2011. And you can now see actually in the neighborhoods, you can see those projects that have actually come forward as ideas on the website. And then they have been voted on in a budget process, and then they've actually got built, you know. Mm-hmm. And we've been sort of, our last campaign was very much about just showing people photos and say, you know, this could be your idea. This can actually happen. You can actually put something forward on the website and then go through the process with your fellow citizens of prioritizing or deciding what's going to be built. And then it will be built, you know. But people sort of, you know, basic, you know, instinct is, oh, it's not going to matter, you know, because that's what the cynicism, you know, about politics. And there was actually a recent study, a large scale study in America, where they were comparing over many years, you know, on an ideal level of what do citizens want and what gets decided, and what do the corporations and lobbyists want, and what actually gets decided. They were comparing those two things. They were comparing how much influence do citizens have, how much influence do the corporations and lobbyists have. So who do you think won? You know, it's like, you know, it's actually real. This 4-year cycle of voting in the politicians, you know, and then dealing with lobbyists, it is a broken system, you know. And it gives far too much power into, you know, hands of people. And I'm not saying corporations should have no power. Corporations definitely should have their influence and their say. But there needs to be some balance. You know, citizens and, you know, people need to, you know, have a stronger voice.
Do you think this kind of experiences work better in environments in which there is not too much population? We know, for example, that Iceland is a country with about 300,000 citizens. How would you recreate such a concept in countries? For example, Colombia has maybe more than 44 or 45 million citizens. Do you think it may work the same? Or what do you think are the challenges of this kind of explorations of democracy via electronic media?
Well, we have obviously Estonian example. I don't really know how many. 5 million. Yeah. 5 million. Yeah. So 5 million people, which is quite a bit more than 300,000 Icelanders. But this is definitely a really interesting thing to wonder about. Where the we actually believe that it is much easier to start and create a active e-democracy community when it's closer to you, when it's a smaller community and something that just really matters to normal citizens, when they can look out and see, oh, this is something that we decided we should be doing.
Like a local,
like more local, like towns or villages, or even around specific issues, which wouldn't need to be geographically connected, if you see what I mean, just around.
Like the National Health Service in the UK.
But even wider, you could be doing something international around specific issues. But like, I think basically it can work for, I'm not gonna be sort of arrogant and say every size, but I think that in general, it should work up quite high up on the scale. The main problem is not the software. The main problem in all e-democracy is getting people to participate. Yeah. So if I was planning to do try to introduce e-democracy to everybody that has an internet connection in Colombia, I would not start by worrying about the software. I would start by thinking about my marketing, about my public relations and my image, and how do I make it clear to the people without forcing it down the throat that this is really something they should participate in. Do you understand what I'm?
Yes.
I think that's
a much pertinent
issue to consider, because we don't really know if the software will work well for millions of people until we get there, and we can't test it really either anyway. So we just have to do what we generally do, is if there's something wrong with the software, then we find ways to make it work better.
But also I think it's very important is that to start at the local level as well, you know, in neighborhoods, in cities, in municipalities, and those are areas that are all sorts of different sizes, obviously, but you know, many of them are even the similar size as Reykjavik, with some hundreds of thousands of people, so it's like it's not necessarily that you have like one solution that fits a whole country, so it's I think electronic democracy can work in any size of the country, and like the project we're doing with the National Health Service, that's for the whole of the population in England, and that's I don't know how many, 22 million or something that live there, and it's a pretty big issue as well, the health service, it touches almost everybody's life. Well, I mean, it does touch everybody's life. So it's so that's very interesting.
Okay, this leads us to a natural question. What do you believe are the main challenges of electronic democracy in the upcoming years from now? What do you think are the biggest challenges? And maybe also in the long term, because I think there may be also different challenges in the short term and in the long term.
So I think it's two things that are very well connected. One is the participation, to actually let people know that those services exist. That's a big challenge. There's so much noise going on the social media everywhere. And you usually don't have a lot of marketing, and people usually with the Electronic Democracy Project fail to have any marketing budgets. But this is actually something we have been doing in the past. That we have actually been spending quite a bit of money on Facebook advertisements and Google advertisements, things like that. But the second thing is that politicians, on the other end, need to be real. I mean, they need to be listening for real, and they need to be responsive to what happens through those electronic means. Because that's also another reason why people don't participate. Because if nothing happens, if people put forward ideas and prioritize whatever they do, and then nobody is on the other end listening, people are not going to waste the time on it.
Yeah, and also vice versa. The people in the leaders and politicians, they are not going to be spending any time or agreeing on any proposals if there's not a good participation. If nobody's participating, it's just one idea from one person, then it's just one more idea. So that's sort of two sides of the coin. But definitely agree with Róbert. The politicians need to be interested.
We have seen before that Gunnar, the former mayor of Reykjavik, had a relation with the Citizens Foundation. How was this relation between citizens engagement initiative with the former institutions of the capital city of Iceland? How was this partnership?
It was generally really, really good. I mean, it was our connection with the political layer and with Jónknar was we had not regular meetings, but meetings when we needed to, and just ideas thrown around on Facebook or in emails and stuff like that, but in general most of our contact points have been the people in the administration, the people that do the day-to-day work from the end of the city, and that has been generally working quite well, but too many changes in the people. That's been the main problem.